Hello, everyone. It's wonderful to be here and have the distinct honor of being the last speaker of the day, I think. I will keep this short. But just talk a little bit about Surfrider Foundation. We're a grassroots nonprofit environmental organization with 50,000 members, so grassroots members, throughout the world. So in the US alone, we have 80 chapters. And then we also have affiliates in about a dozen other countries. And what we do is beach preservation, water quality, beach access, and protection of special places. So what you heard my colleague Chad Nelson talk about at the beginning of that first video was the protection of the very special place, Trestles Surf Break. How many of you guys have been to Trestles or heard of Trestles? Just a handful. OK. Well, we call it the last pristine watershed in Orange County. It's actually in San Diego County, but it's on the border. So our South Orange County chapter was the one very much involved with this fight. It actually took all of the departments at our headquarters based in San Clemente here working on the campaign for over a decade, which culminated in 2008 with a California Coastal Commission hearing and in the decision after 3,000 people showed up, 3,000 to 5,000 people debate on the on how many were actually at the hearing, showing up and advocating for protection of this very important surf break. So I'll go into a little bit into the legal aspects and campaign components of that fight and why it was so important to this global movement for a greener 21st century. But first, I'll tell you a little bit about myself and how I got plopped right in the middle of that fight. I grew up in Texas, very much in tune with the environment, loved the outdoors, and just wanted to make the world a better place. I mean, don't we all? So I decided to go to law school. Knowing that 85% of students, even at Berkeley where I went to law school, go into the corporate world, and that there was a big threat of getting the golden handcuffs is what they call it, getting attached to the money that you make in the corporate world and attached to the lifestyle. I still went into the corporate world after law school and spent 2 years at a large DC-based firm and worked in their environmental practice group, luckily mostly research and not defending the bad guys, and did a lot of nonprofit work, a lot of pro bono work. They encouraged me to get involved with my community. And I did that through Surfrider Foundation, which a friend had mentioned to me. I started with the grassroots chapter. I was a volunteer. I became on the executive committee of the West LA Malibu chapter. And I heard about the job opening for the in-house, it was called litigation manager at that point, position at Surfrider Foundation. So that was almost 5 years ago. I applied and luckily enough got the job and was able to transition to where my heart was in the public interest. Right in the middle of that transition was also probably the biggest campaign that Surfrider has ever undertaken in their 27-year history, and that was the Save Trestles fight, also known as Save San Onofre State Beach. This fight was so impressive, not only for the amount of people that were engaged with it, but also for the environmental coalition that was involved. We had about a dozen environmental groups, including Gary's Coast Keepers, NRDC, Sierra Club, Endangered Habitats League, State Parks Foundation, and a handful of others. Highly committed. We're still on calls every Tuesday to talk about this. It's actually ongoing. I'll update you guys on the status of the case. But everyone pulled their resources, and they pulled every resource. They pulled from their media department, including social media, Twitter, to get people engaged into the hearing. We actually tweeted on the hearing when we were there. We pulled from our environmental department, you know, how will this affect water quality? How will it affect sedimentation, including the surf break? Endangered species, including Pacific pocket mouse, arroyo toad, steelhead trout, the gnatcatcher, and from every other group, including our membership and our legal department. So to go into a little bit about what our legal department did in that case, I have my brief notes on my little phone. We first were engaged with the Coastal Act, try to get that off, defending the project under the Coastal Act. So our main target was the California Coastal Commission. And the hearing in 2008 was before the 10-panel commission. It's actually has 12 members, but only 10 showed up. And it went all day. It went till 10 p.m. at night, I believe. It was a very long day. 3,000 people from the public showed up to talk to the Coastal Commission, our appointed body, in charge of enforcing the protections of the 1976 California Coastal Act, about why this land is sacred to them. And we had our attorney crew talk about the protections afforded for environmentally sensitive habitat area, ESHA, under the Coastal Act, public access, visual rights, water quality, all these components of the California Coastal Act that needed to be upheld with this case. And the staff report was in our favor. It actually said that they could not envision a more environmentally damaging location to put this toll road than smack dab through a watershed and a state park that leads to the best surf break in the continental US. they also said surfing is the epitome of the low impact environmental or low impact recreational resource that they're trying to protect. And so it was very favorable. However, the political environment was not favorable. Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger, who appoints 4 out of the 12 voting members of the California Coastal Commission, was in favor of the toll road, wanted it to be there. Clint Eastwood, who you saw on the earlier slide, was actually kicked off the State Parks Commission because he was not in favor of the toll road either, and Arnold was the one who appointed him. so it was very controversial politically. The person we're battling was the TCA, the Transportation Corridors Agency, who's in the business of making toll roads. So they're very profitable when they have more roads and more tolls to collect. But through the sound policies of the Coastal Act and the Coastal Commission's will to uphold it, they voted 8-2, including 2 appointees by the governor, to uphold the Coastal Act and deny the TCA's permit for development in that area. The TCA, however, did not give up. They still haven't given up. They appealed the California Coastal Commission's ruling up to the Secretary of Commerce. Why the Secretary of Commerce? Well, it was actually under the Coastal Zone Management Act, the California Coastal Commission ruled on the project. So for this consistency certification, they could appeal to the next administrative body that oversees the Coastal Commission, and that was the Secretary of Commerce of the US. Being a Bush appointee, we didn't have much hope. However, we did have a lot of good attorneys on our staff, willing to look at the CZMA rules and willing to write amazing appeals. There was also another hearing down in Del Mar, the fairgrounds in San Diego, where the Secretary of Commerce stood there for all day. I think it was another 18-hour day. Heard public comment, heard from the NGOs. There was another 3,000 people at this hearing with the will to save the toll road. And 3 months later, we heard from the Secretary of Commerce, and they denied the appeal of the Transportation Corridors Agency. So huge, huge victories for the California coastline, and primarily due to activists. I mean, I talked about our amazing coalition, the campaign, but it really started with the people. To get 3,000 to 5,000 people to a public hearing, to take off work, to go to a public hearing, to sit there all day, and to maybe have a chance to speak is just a testament to how much this body of water, this coastal park, meant to people and how much they wanted to preserve it. And so we went against the odds of politics, went against the odds of money, who was the power player here, not the NGOs. We weren't the deep pockets in this case. But it was really the will of the people that bubbled up and actually saved the day for these two cases. So just I think it's just a talks speaks to the importance of grassroots and the global movement. And it actually says, it shows that you can be really proactive. You can garner these the grassroots people to change the embedded structure that would have normally gone against the will of the people, because where the power lies is really with the people who get out there to speak up and change, you know, just the people with the deep pockets and the politicians. Didn't matter in this case. It was the people with the will to see something protected. So I think I've gone through almost everything. and I just want to...
Sustainability fellows.
Yeah, absolutely. I just wanted to introduce my sustainability fellows. There actually are Surfrider Legal Department interns. You have the entirety of the Surfrider Legal Department staff here today. We have Kirk Tracy and Natasha Busan, if you guys want to come up or just say something. Yeah. If you want to speak a little bit about how you heard about Surfrider and what you're hoping to do with your legal career.
I'm Kirk. I've met a few of you or a lot of you so far this week. I'm in law school at Tulane University in New Orleans. Lots of environmental issues there, which is why I chose that law school. Similar to Natasha, I specifically want to work in environmental law, and Surfrider gives me a chance to do that all summer long. I hadn't actually worked with a nonprofit group before, aside from little one-off volunteer opportunities. I've got some work experience in the corporate world, so this is my chance to have like a rebirth, I guess, in my career. So I'm really happy to be here. Have been here all week, and just to be part of this group. So thanks, everybody.
I love hearing about all of the success stories, and what I tend to find that I learn the most from pitfalls, the hiccups that come along the way. And I was curious if there are any kind of lessons learned. I know you mentioned you won all of your litigation efforts. I think that's phenomenal. It shows the testament to the environmental law movement. But if you have any points that you'd like to talk about, something that negatively impacted, something you didn't see that came along the way, something that that if we were working in this field, something we should watch out for, and possibly.
Yeah, I can start. I actually have one that was passed down to me from Chad Nelson, who you saw speak earlier. We had a litigation against the Headlands development in Dana Point. We didn't want that huge mega mansion development right on the coast. We thought it was going to impact environmentally sensitive habitat area, along with beach access. And Surfrider, before I got there, filed a lawsuit to stop that. We lost the lawsuit, and then the bulldozers were out the next day before we could even file an appeal. So I would say always go for a preliminary injunction.
Put that in your mind.
But we're still fighting to this day to keep the beach access that was part of the development agreement. And we also monitor and remain vigilant watchdogs to make sure they have the environmentally sensitive habitat area open for people. That was part of the development agreement as well. So I would say the lesson learned is, in addition to preliminary injunction, when you get knocked down, keep on it. And also, even with the TCA today, there's a story in the San Clemente Times this past weekend about how they're still looking to put the toll road straight through a state park after thousands of people have voiced their will not to. And we're still having those calls today. You know, we're trying to maintain this openness. So it's really sticking with the cause, maintaining vigilance, and maintaining your passion about it.
I would just add to what was being said is on the Headlands project, one of the big issues that we got involved in Surfrider was the armoring of the coast and the huge seawall that they wanted to build to protect the mega mansions. And that was only a year after the state and the Coastal Commission had basically passed statewide policy saying that you can't armor the coast and basically let the natural processes prevail. And yet, it always comes back to follow the money, because one of the major investors in that development was the California CalPERS, which is California Public Employees Retirement System. And so they had incredible influence in Sacramento. And it was just, you know, incredible. But that was a huge disappointment. And also the toll road, you know, what part of no don't they understand?
Well, I think the part of the lesson there that I all speak for all of us in the field is that you never really win. That's why we're so happy that the next generation is sitting here before us, because we want to be able to retire and enjoy knowing that it's in good hands. Because this fight that was so well fought by all of us in the community, it's not going away. It's still gurgling and waiting for the time to come up. And the same for the Headlands project. You know, I was at the Ocean Institute, and we fought that in lots of ways for many years. That developer waited patiently until the political environment was just right. They got the one extra vote they needed in city council, and off they went. The bulldozers were out the next day. Yeah. It's almost scary how much pressure there is constantly, and I guess I would say to all of you, thank goodness you're here, because you're needed.
I mentioned the ASBS, the Area of Special Biological Significance, that we basically, in 2000, we were the first to enforce that. We won that battle, but it opened Pandora's box for the entire state. And so we're still going to meetings, trying to figure out ways on working with the state and working with the developers and working with cities who want to basically throw it out and just basically say, you know, we can't afford. And one of the frustration parts now in this economy since 2008 is we'll go to a hearing to talk about a tougher water quality standard or a new permit on MS4, our stormwater permits, whatever, and we'll have the cities march in with their unemployment figures. And somehow they connect the dots that it's unfortunate right now we have high rate of employment and cities are having a very difficult time, but the implied message is let's go back to the good old days and let's throw out all this stuff because we can't afford it.